do it, you have sin. Because that is the fault. And some ulama say no, because Allah say fala junaha alaykum. If it is obligatory, Allah will not say fala junaha alaykum, there is no blame upon you. Also, if it is fard, logically, if traveler, somebody who is making kasr, he came to the masjid and he met the imam, praise Lord. The imam is not a traveler. It is obligatory for the person that travel to follow his salat here. It's wajib. Had it been the kasr, the turaka is kasr is obligatory for a traveler. He cannot pray for somebody who is not a traveler. So this is the problem. Any journey, I support that idea. Maybe through that Allah will put nur in his heart and then he will repent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us understanding. And that is the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa and Ibn Taymiyyah. We come back. Is qasr obligatory or not? According to Imam Abu Hanifa, it's obligatory. And that is why he said, even if your journey is for this thing, you have to make two. According to Imam Abu Hanifa. According to Imam Malik, Malikiya, is sunnah mu'akkada. It's a strong sunnah. Okay? And according to Shafi'iyah and Hanabila, it's ruhsa. If you like, you do two. If you like, you do four. There's hadith. You know Aisha, she was dealing with the Prophet. We will read the hadith, inshallah. And وَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ هُوَ فَرِيدًا يَعْنِي الْقَصْرُ السَّفَرُ وَالْخَوْفُ فَرَدْ. They say all is obligatory. Some say sunnah, some say it's ruhsa. As I said, there is hadith through Abdullah ibn Umar. I think this hadith is in Sahih Bukhari. He said, "Inni sahibtu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi safar. I have been accompanying the Prophet in journey. Falam yazid ala rak'atayn hatta qabalahu Allah." The Prophet never ever prayed full in his journey till Allah take him. And he also said, I pray with Abu Bakr the same. I never see him, he pray full in journey. I pray with Omar, I pray with Usman, all of them like that. This hadith was narrated by Ibn Umar. But there is another hadith that confirmed that Usman, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was praying with a Sahaba on journey and he makes his salat full. And he, Abdullah ibn Umar, was among them. They asked him, I think Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. They asked him, then he said, I don't support him, but to avoid fitna. To avoid fitna, that's why I follow him. But the most authentic saying that, there is hadith also in Sahih, in Nasa'i, the little hadith, through Aisha. قالت لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Aisha said to the Prophet, they were going to Huma Umrah, she and the Prophet, and she said, Ya Rasulullah, kasarta wa atmant. Allahu Akbar. She was with the Prophet. Prophet make kasar, and she make salat full. She didn't make kasar. She said, kasart wa atmant, wa aftart wa sumt. And you eat, but me, I'm fasting. You know, laysa minal birri siyam fi safar. But she says, she make fasting. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Khair ma fa'alti ya Aisha. What you did is okay." But some ulama, they didn't like Ibn Taymiyyah, they say this hadith because they don't think it's logic for Aisha. She's with the Prophet. The Prophet is doing something different. She too, she's doing different. You know, ulama of hadith, we have hadith police, detectors of hadith. They try to detect it. Maybe they can find some distance. But this Imam Shafi'i and Ahmed ibn Hanbal, they take it. Because a lot of Sahaba, they prayed for at the back of Usman, they didn't deny him, so they take it that no problem. And that's why they said, Al-Musafir Amiru Nafsi. Traveler is the Amir, he's the prince, he's the king of himself. Inshallah, if you like, you pray for, if you like, you make two. But if you take the opinion of those who say it's obligatory, then if you make four, you have problem. Wallahu alam. When should a person make kasr? Iza darabtum fil ardi, iza azamtum ala safar. Some ulama said, The ayah of إذا ضربت الفلادة إذا عزمت, if you make the intention to travel, فاصل, then you start قصر. That's what I'm saying. That is, if I'm going to Berlin or I'm going to some place, I pack my luggage, then they make azan for Zuhur, then I'm in my house, I will make 2 rakah. But this opinion is weak. This opinion is marjuh, it's weak. We don't work with it. The best thing is, you are not allowed to make qasr unless if you go out of your town. Because there's hadith, لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هنا سافر من مكة إلى من مدينة إلى مكة ردا. When one of the journeys of the Prophet, he was traveling to from مكة, from Medina to Mecca, صلى زهر بالمدينة أربعة. زهر reached him. He was in Medina, and he prayed 4 rakah زهر in Medina. فصلى عصر ثم صلى عصر بذي الحليفة ركعتين. And on his way, when he reached Hulayfa, he stopped there and he prayed Asr, because Asr reached him there, he prayed Rakah 2 rakah. He prayed Asr 2 rakah. So this means, if you are going, you are a traveler, you want to travel, you will not start the qasr at home. If Salat reaches you, you have to sit, you are in your house, even in your town, you have to make it full. May Allah give us understanding. Now, so this is the best opinion. Wasafir, wal musafir bis safina, somebody who is traveling in a boat, you make your, you take your luggage, your everything, you go and take the boat, you enter the boat. When the boat move, you can make qasr, even if you are in your territory. But as far as the boat is standing, you cannot make qasr. The same thing, if you are in ta'ira, bad and tukli at ta'ira, after the flight has taken off, but if it is standing, you cannot make qasr. But there is some ulama to say, no, if you are, your house is very far away from the airport, immediately you enter airport, you can start qasr. It's another opinion. But the best opinion is that when the flight took off. So, I'm going to Paris. Then I went to France. I sit in France. How long should I stay there? I can make qasr. This is also polemic. Some say 3 days. Some say 4 days. Some say 15 days. Imam Abu Hanifa said 15 days. Imam Malik said, if where you go, you get about 20 salat, you have to complete yourself. You have to stop qasr. That is, you only make qasr on your way. Oh, I'm going to France, I will do 5 days. 5 days is more than 20 salat. This is the mazhab of Imam Malik. Then Imam Shafi'i, I think he supports the same idea. If you reach there, then you start qasr. You start completing your salat. Some ulama, they say 3 days. Some, they say 15 days, like Imam Abu Hanifa. For him, 15 days. After 15 days, you make your destiny. And some ulama say, you know, you stay there 1 year, as far as you don't know, you don't have the intention to be in the town, you have to make it qasr. Especially if you go, Imam Malik, even in the mazhab of Malikiya, they said, if you go to the town and maybe you are going to do something, you don't know when you will finish. For that one, you will be doing qasr till the day that you come back, whether it is 1 year. This is the mazhab of Imam Malik. But if you know that, no, in four days, sure, but after 4 days, I will be back. For that one, you reach there, you have to stop salat. You have to stop qasr. But like Muhakkikin, like Ibn Qayyim and Ku, they said, no. If you go there, as far as you don't have the intention of staying in the town, there's different between that. Maybe you are working in here, then they transfer you to Berlin. For that one, you know you are going to stay there. If you reach there, you have to be completing your salat. But you go to do something, and what you are doing, don't know when you will finish. For that one, you'll be doing qasr. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stayed in Tabuk, I think 20 days. He was making qasr, then he came back. So what is the hujjah, what is the evidence of Imam Malik and the Malikis, they make explanation that the 20 days that the Prophet did in Tabuk, he don't know when he was coming back. He went for expedition. And if they succeed in a day, in a 2 day, in a 3 days, they should have come back. But they don't know. You know, so that is how it is. But we know that if you travel, you are going to do something. As far as you don't have the intention to stay there, then you make a circle till the time that you come back. May Allah give us understanding. Qasr is a gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given us. So we have to take it. You have to take it, because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made something very easy for you, and you say you don't want the easy, you want long process, somebody who make the qasr might have more ajr even than you. He have his full ajr. He also work with the saying of Allah, and also the doing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All this one gives ajr. So we have to consider it. And where Allah say, in khiftum an yafsinakum الذين كفروا لا مفهوم له لا مفهوم له it has no mafhum. You cannot take that. The journey has to be a journey that you fear. It's not necessary. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to the Prophet. He said, وَإِذَا ضَرَبْتُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ, if you travel in earth, فَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جُنَاحٌ, there is no blame upon you, أَنْ تَقْصُرُوا مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ, that you shorten your prayer, بِأَنْ تَرُدُّوها مِنْ أَرْبَعَ إِلَى اثْنَيْنِ, all the ruba'iyat, salawat that we do them four, do two. You cannot, Maghrib, you cannot do it. You say qasr, because three, you cannot share three into two. Three raka, if I went to do it, two, can you do 1.5 raka? 1.5 raka. Maybe you do, after kira, you don't make ruku, you go straight to sujood. Now, the qasr will do it, only the ruba'iyat. Then he said, فَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جَانْتَكْ سُرُوا مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ إِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَنْ يَفْتِنَكُمْ أَيَّنَا لُكُمْ بِمَكْرُوهِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَا مَفْهُومَ لَهُ. There is no mafhum on this. إِنَّ الْكَافِرِينَ كَانُوا لَكُمْ عَدُوًّا مُبِينًا. The disbelievers, they are your manifest enemies. Now.
وَإِذَا كُنْتَ فِيهِمْ فَأَقَمْتَ لَهُمُ الصَّلَاةِ فَلْتَقُمْ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ مَعَكَ وَلْيَأْخُذُوا أَسْلِحَتَهُمْ فَإِذَا سَجَدُوا فَلْيَكُونُوا مِن وَرَائِكُمْ ولتأت طائفة أخرى لم يصلوا فليصلوا معك وليأخذوا حذرهم وأسلحتهم ود الذين كفروا لو تغفلون عن أسلحتكم وأمتعتكم فيميمون عليكم ميلة واحدة ولا جناح عليكم إن كان بكم أذى من مطر إن كان بكم أذى من مطر أو كنتم مرضى أن تضعوا أسلحتكم وخذوا حذركم إن الله أعد للكافرين عذابا مهينا.
الله أكبر. This ayah. الله أكبر. You wake up, you dream of takbir? Allahu Akbar. This ayah shows us that salat is very, very obligatory. There's no way Allah will forgive person if he didn't make salat. No way. Because it is the pillar of deen. وَهُوَ حَبْلُ اللَّهِ الْمَتِينِ. It is the rope of Allah, the strong rope of Allah. It is the relation, the communion between the servant and Allah. It is the sign by which we can differentiate between the Muslim and the kafir. It is the time that the servant come very closer to salat, to Allah. It is the time when you make sujood, you come very closer to Allah. It is the most sweetest situation, condition, communion that any believer or any pious man or any taqi mu'min will have. And that is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. He said, my happiness, my pleasure is being put in salat. Allahu Akbar. وَإِذَا حَزَبَهُ الْعَمَرُ بَادَرَ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ. Whenever any problem, any hard situation come overtakes him, he run and go to salat. If you are sick, you have to make salah. If you cannot do it standing, you do it sitting. If you cannot do it sitting, you do it lying. If you cannot do it lying, you can even make salat with only your eye. Allah will take it. There is no way the Muslim, as far as you are in your mind, okay? As far as you are in your mind, that Allah will forgive you salat. Ma salakakum fi sakar. Qalu lam nakum min al-musallin. So if the Muslims are at the battlefield, fighting the enemies, cutting each other with sword, with arrow, with spears, and Allah didn't forgive them salat, then what about me and we are sitting very enjoying AC or you are on your sofa. They call Azan, you are sleeping. May Allah forgive us. Somebody who is at battlefield, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't forgive him salat. Allah is talking to the Prophet. He said, وَإِذَا كُنْتَ فِيهِمْ يَا مُحَمَّدْ. Muhammad, if you are among them, وَأَنْتُمْ تَخَافُونَ, whereby you fear, you are in war, فَأَقَمْتَ لَهُمُ الصَّلَاةِ, and you stand to lead them in prayer, فَلْتَكُمْ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ مَعَكُمْ, let some group of them stand with you in prayer. This, we have to listen very well. There are different situations. There are in a situation whereby the Muslims, they are fighting with the Kuffar, and the Kuffar, they are coming to the Muslims from the direction of Qibla. Okay? And there are other situations whereby they are fighting the disbelievers, but the Kuffar, they are coming from direction which is not of Qibla. And there are situations too when they are fighting, the disbelievers come from all directions. The salat will not be the same. The salat will not be the same. And here Allah said, if you are with them, then you want to pray salat with them. فَلْتُكُمْ تَعِفَةٌ مِنْهُمْ, let some group, some party of the Sahaba stand with you. وَلْتَتَأَخَّرْ تَعِفَةٌ, and let the other group stand back and guide. This is in a situation whereby the Kuffar, they are coming from direction which is not Qibla. Okay? Like here is Qibla, the opposite of Qibla, or they are coming from this side. So one of the Muslims, one group have to stand with the Prophet, guide them, is praying with them, then the other group will go and guide. فَلْيَكُونُ, am I right? They should hold their weapons. Ma'hum, with them. فَإِذَا سَجَدُوا, if they make sujood, فَلِيَكُونُوا طَائِفَةُ الْأُخْرَى مِنْ وَرَائِكُمْ, let the other group that are not praying be your back and guide you. Okay? وَلْتَاتُ طَائِفَةُ الْأُخْرَى, after he make the prostration, he wake up, let the other group also come. Okay? Here, in order to explain it very well, the ahadith that talk about Salat al-Khawf, they are many. They are many. Many hadiths. The Prophet didn't do Salat al-Khawf once. Some say he prayed with every group two raka'ah. He prayed with this group two raka'ah. Okay? The other group will go and guide. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will pray with the first group two raka'ah. Then he makes salam alaykum. Those they make salam alaykum. Okay? Then they go. Then the other group come. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also prayed two raka'ah. With this one, the other one are guided, and this one to pray their two raka'ah, he makes salam alaykum. In this situation, the Prophet has prayed two raka'ah two times. The first one is his fard, and the second one is sunnah. And that is why some ulama take that somebody who is making fard can follow somebody who is making sunnah. Am I clear here? Some different narrations said no, he prayed one raka'ah with each one, because now the qasr, normally the normal salat of qasr is two raka'ah. So now he make kasr in kasr because there is in war. So he stand, he pray one raka'ah with people, he makes salamu alaikum, they go and stand, and other raka'ah, he pray one raka'ah with them. Them two, they make salamu alaikum, they go. He will get two, they will have one. Another narration also say no, he will pray one raka'ah. When he wake up, he will stand, then he read qira'ah, long recitation. Then those who are back will complete another raka'ah and make salam alaikum. This is the situation where they agree the ma'mum to make salam alaikum before imam. Okay? Then they will go. Then the other group too will come. The Prophet will make one raka'ah with them. He will sit down and wait them for them to wake up and complete. Then he makes salam alaikum. Then they make salam alaikum. He got takbiratul ihram with the first group. Then he got salah with the other group. All this one, they are seeing. of Salatul Khawf. But Quran didn't see, Quran just said it once. And the Prophet did it several situations. He did all, as I said, he did all like that. And that is what Allah is telling, وَإِذَا كُنْتَ فِيهِمْ if you are among them, فَأَكَمْتَ لَهُمُ الصَّلَاةَ and you stand to pray with them, فَلْتَكُمْ تَعِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ عَدْ let some group stand with you and pray with you, فَلْيَكُونُوا مِنْ وَرَائِكُمْ and the other group stand back. وَلْتَكْ تَعِفَةٌ أُخُرَى لَمِنْ صَلِّي that is after they finish their salat, they go back and the other group that didn't pray, they come, وَلْيُصَلُّوا مَعَكْ and pray with you. Am I clear here? وَلْيَأْخُذُوا حِذْرَهُمْ and let them take their precaution. They are fighting, they have to take precaution, holding their arms. When it said, وَلْيَأْخُذُوا أَسْلِحَتَهُمْ there are two tafsir here. The first tafsir is that those who are standing at the back of the Prophet, they will not hold their arms. Those who are guided, they have to hold arms. Some narration said, no. Even those that are praying at the back of the Prophet, they have to be with their arms. They have to be, because Allah said, وَلْيَأْخُذُوا حِذْرَهُمْ they have to get precaution. وَدَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا those who disbelieve will like that you will neglect and aslihatum, neglect your weapons, that you will leave your weapons aside and be praying, wa amtiatikum and your equipment, fayamiluna alaykum maylatan wahida, so that they can attack you in one assault, in one attack. And that's why Allah said, hold your arms even if you're fighting. But he said, wala junaha alaykum in kana bikum adha, there is no blame upon you if there is reason of min matar, of rain. Or you are sick, and tada'u aslihatakum, then you put the arms down. Here, he is giving that those who are praying at the back of the Prophet, those who are guided for them, they have to hold their arms. But if there is rainfall, there is mud that will disturb them, if they have the arms, then Allah said, then they have to put their arms down and pray. But those who are guiding, they have to hold their own. Okay? Here, he's talking to those who are standing at the back. Then he said, وَخُذُوا حِذْرَكُمْ take precaution إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَدَّى لِلْكَافِرِينَ عَذَابًا مُهِينًا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had make a provision of very demeaning punishment for the disbelievers. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was in a ghazwa, in a war called Bani Ammar, after Allah has given him victory upon the disbelievers, there was a little bit drizzling. So the Prophet went further, then he sat under some tree, just to relax. And a man called Gawraf, one of the kuffar of Bani Ammar, he came to the Prophet. Then he said, now I saw this man sitting. He hasn't seen me. So if this man escaped from me today, then my mother didn't want me. He went to the Prophet. He removed his sword. He forgot himself. Then he asked the Prophet. He said, man yamna'uka minni ya Muhammad. Who will protect you? Who can save you from me today? Fakar Rasul Allah. And the Prophet said Allah, and the sword fell down from his hand. And the Prophet took the sword. He started shaking. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took the sword. وقال, man yamna'uka minni? Who will save you from me now? قال لا أحد. He said nobody. For him, he said nobody. He knows nobody can save me from Rasulullah. The Prophet said, تقول لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. He said, لا أقول. I will not say it. ولكن لا أحاربك أبدا. I will never fight you. ولا أكون مع من يحاربك. And I will not also help those who are fighting you. And the Prophet forgave him. And when he came to his people, he directed this to them. Have some of them embrace Islam. They say, this is a good man. They went to the Prophet and take Islam. And some too didn't. This salat that I said is whereby the Muslims, the enemies are coming not from the direction of Qibla. If the enemies are coming from the direction of Qibla, that one is different. That one, they will all, since, let's say here is Qibla, and the enemies are coming from here. The Imam, they will all face Qibla. The Imam will stand front and they will make two saf. Imam will make Allahu Akbar, he will read Quran, he will make ruku, they will all make ruku. Because if they are coming, they will see them. They will go, here you are making salah, but you are watching, no problem. They will make ruku. Then they go, Sami'a Allahu liman hamida. Then they wake up. They go sujood, Allahu Akbar. Then the first saf, only the first saf makes sujood. Am I clear? The second saf, they are standing. This saf will make their sujood, okay? And then they will wake up. if they wake up. We have two riwaya here. We have two riwaya. One riwaya said, if those who are the first place, if they wake up, they will come back. They will come to the second saf, and those who are the back will go front and make their two sujood, then they wake up. Some riwaya to say, no, they will make the sujood at the back, after where they are. If they finish the sujood before they make the exchange with those who are front. I don't know if you are clear here. There are two hadiths that explain like that. So all the same, the first group, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he make Allahu Akbar, he read his Fatiha, he make surah, he make his ruku, they make ruku, he wake up, when you go sujood, those who are the first row only go, the second row they stand, they guard. When they finish, they wake up, then the second, this one, then they make their sujood. Then they make exchange. Allahu Akbar. The next exchange, these two people come from, these two come back. The Prophet also make another Fatiha, another surah. He make ruku, they all make ruku. He makes Sami Allahu liman hamida. They make Sami Allahu liman hamida. He go to sujood, then the first row goes sujood. You know, those who make, now making sujood, they were those who make the second sujood in the first rak'ah. And now they are making the first sujood in the first rak'ah. In the second rak'ah, rather. So when they wake up, then these people, this time, they will not come back. They remain at where they are. They make their sujood, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam make his tahiyya, then they make salamu alaykum. At-takbir. So, salat al-khawf. If you are in the desert, then lion started to chase you. Lion is chasing you. Then your phone is calling, Allahu Akbar. Will you make salam? It's khawf. It's also fear. It's like you are the battlefield.
This one, no, khawf is different.
Huh?
This khawf is different khawf.
It's the same.
Only the mujahideen can follow me.
No, this one. Yes, this one. No. This man cannot do. This one will run. He will sleep.
No.
You see? And if the enemies, they attack the Muslims from all angle, or they are engaged with each other in fighting, for that one, they make salah. I think the ayah will say it. They are fighting, and they are make takbir, Allahu Akbar, and that is their salat. The same thing, if lion is chasing you, you are running, you are making your Fatiha. After Fatiha, they read Ayat Kursi, because maybe Ayat Kursi can even prevent, drive the lion away. Allahu Akbar. You can forget this too. Allahu Akbar. May Allah give us understanding. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this ayah, we can understand how important salat is. Okay, my question here is, what about if the salat al-khawf is salat al-maghrib? Three rak'ah. If it is salat al-maghrib, some riwaya said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will pray three rak'ah with every group. First group three rak'ah, second group three rak'ah. And some different riwaya say no, he will pray two rak'ah with the first one. Okay? When he sits, he wake up, the other one they complete their own, then the other group come, he pray one rak'ah with them, then they two they complete. Riwayat. So may Allah give us understanding. What we have to learn? Here we say, there is ayah in Quran where Allah said, إِذَا لَقِيْتُمُ الْفِئَةِ فَثْبُتُوا وَاذْكُرُ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. That is, if you meet, if you clash with the disbelievers at the battlefield where you are engaged with each other in fighting, and it's time for prayer, then make zikr. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, that is your salat. May Allah give us understanding. This verse in particular tells us how important salat is. Tells us that man, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will never ever forgive you salat as far as you are in your mind. So those who used to be lazy, those who used to be heedless with salat, they have to see how important salat is. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't forgive those who are even at the battlefield to neglect salat, then what about me and you that today we used to sleep, we pray we don't go at war. We are living in peace. So you are living in peace and we are not praying. What will we tell Allah? Just because of hijrah, some people didn't do hijrah, they say the angels will ask them, what is wrong with you? Then what about you? You are a place where you have the freedom to worship Allah, to make everything, and you refuse to do. What are you going to tell Allah? Allah said, فَإِذَا قَضَيْتُمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Now,
فإذا قضيتم الصلاة فاذكروا الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبكم فإذا اطمأنتم فأقيموا الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا
فإذا قضيتم الصلاة and if you finish your salat pray فاذكروا الله بالتهليل. If you finish, you are fighting, you have to be tahleel. Allahu Akbar, subhanallah. It put fear in the heart of the disbeliever. He said, qiyaman, when standing, qu'udan, when sitting, wa ala junubikum, even if you are lying on your side, fa'idhat ma'anantum. But if you are secured, fa'aqimu salat, then perform prayer. Adduha bihuquqiha. Then make the salat with its right. Inna salata kanat alil mu'minina kitaban mawquta. Definitely, salah. It's been made obligatory for believers at a specific time. Salat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala don't want us to be living the salat for the time to go out before we do. And that's why he make specific time for it. Because you know, if he live it without time, man will say, I will do. Up to now, we'll be sitting and say, we will do and we didn't do. And that is why he make time for it. And all the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say we should do is for our own benefit. The benefit comes to ourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made salat obligatory and he made the raka'at to be very few. Because had it been he did it more, we should have problem of doing it. He made it 5 salawat, fil yawm wa layla, 5 times in a day and night, instead of 50. Because in the beginning, the salat was 50. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by through his mercy, he reduced it to 5. فقال ان الله تقول محمد سيدنا محمد هي 5 صلوات في اليوم والليله ومن جاء بالحسنه فله 10 امثالها. It's 5 صلوات in a day. Anybody who do good deeds, he will get the ajr 10 times. فتلك 50 صلاه. So if you pray 5 times a day, still you have the ajr of 50 صلوات. Since in the beginning the salat, the beginning of salat was 50 rak'at. And the kuffar, they refuse to make salat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let them see one day of qiyamah as 50,000 years. Ja'ala Allahu alayhim yawm al-qiyamati 50 alf sana kull salat alf am. Because they refuse to make salat. So they see qiyamah to be longer. Salat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do each salat according to 8 times, Salat al-Subh, Zuhur, Asr, Maghrib, and Isha. You don't have to wait at night, then you join all the 5. Or you wake up in the morning, you say, I'm going out, I will not get time. Then you do Subh, Zuhur, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. It's not accepted. It's not accepted. May Allah give us understanding. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order to make it very easy for us, he make the time to be tawsi'. He make the time longer. The time we have time al-daruri and time al-mukhtar. Although some mazahib, they don't accept that one, but that one exists. So may Allah give us understanding. Well, Allah didn't force you. If you do, he give you Jannah. And because in order to remind us, he said mu'azzin should be calling prayer. So that even if you forget, you hear azan, you remember that you have to go and pray. And also he told us to be making salat in jama'ah. He said, aqimu salat. We make iqamah. Aqimu salat. Iqamah. And he also said, warka'u ma'ar raki'in. That is, we have to pray in jama'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to have khushu. Concentration in our salat. He said, inna salat. He said, alladhina fi salatihim khashu'un. Those who are very 100% concentrated in their salat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we said, he makes salat 50 raka'ah. And if you like, if you pray 5, he will give you 50 ajr. And at the same time, you can get another extra 50 ajr. You can get it. Because for salawatul khams, the 5 daily prayers that we pray, all of them, if you add all the raka'ahs, how many? 17 raka'ah. Is it correct? We have mathematicians here. If you add Shafi'i and Witri, they become how many? 20. Thank you. Anybody who will be doing Raka'at al-Fajr, and 2 Raka'ah Duha, 4 Raka'ah before Zuhur, 4 Raka'ah after Zuhur, 4 Raka'ah before Asr, 2 raka'a after Maghrib, 2 raka'a after Isha or before Isha, and 10 raka'a before Shafi and Witr. If you join all, you have 50 raka'a at Takbir. You see, you have 50 plus 50. Are we doing that? How many, Shafi, how many times you do this? Allah vice. So this is to encourage us.
Sometimes you are very intelligent. Yeah.
Subhanallah. Otherwise, Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our salat, we don't have to be taking it with joke. Our salat will be our friends in the grave. Grave is the house of loneliness. And that is why Shaitan prayed to Allah in order to escape grave. Shaitan thinks that if Allah put him in hell, he will not be punished alone. There are a lot of people. We are punishing him. You also see people that Allah are punishing. But in grave, subhanAllah, nobody is there. Punishment with loneliness. And Shaitan, because he is a little bit, not more intelligent, more intelligent, he said, Rabbi anzurni ila yawmi bafu. He don't want to enter grave. And Allah said, oh, innaka min al-munzarin. But if you are somebody who used to pray 5 times, you don't have problem. They put you, they say, so ulama said, you have some angels who will come with you and come and sit with you and be talking with you till Asr come, till Zuhr come, Zuhr too. They will go and Zuhr will come, just like the way there are angels who, you know, used to come and take your ajr after you pray Salat. You know, that place hadith, the Prophet said, Yom al-Jum'ah, some angels, they used to come and stand in front of Masjid. And then they will be writing the name of people who are entering one by one. All this, they can console you in the grave. So my brothers, we don't have to pray with Salat. Salat is the weapon of the moment. Salat is the solution of all your problems. If you always pray 5 times, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of your problems. Even if you have problem, you tell Allah, Allah will solve it. But if you don't pray, you stop prayers, you make everything. After you have problem, then you come to Sheikh. Sheikh, please pray for me. If Sheikh don't pray, can Sheikh pray for you? If Sheikh don't make hamsu salawat, can he make dua for you? So this is why we have to try to reflect. Our salawat, we have to try. We shouldn't let work. You know, especially in Europe here, we have problem with work. Arbeit, you say, some of us, even if we go to some work, we fear to make salat there because we fear that if we pray, they see, they will sack us. The work, and you yourself, and the country, and the factory, all belongs to Allah. Wallahi ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard. All what is in the heavens and the earth belongs to Allah. If your iman is very strong, my brother, Allah says, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. If you know that, then Muslim, let them know you are Muslim anywhere you go. Let them know you are Muslim. Let them know you are a good Muslim. You are not somebody who claim to be a Muslim. Let them see the conduct of Islam in you. The good moralities, the way the Prophet ﷺ treated non-believers. We just said just now, somebody came and took the soul of the Prophet and said, who will save him? And when the Prophet got rid of him, the Prophet forgive him. If it is you, maybe you will not forgive him. You will execute him. But idfa' billati hi ahsan. That's what Quran says. Idfa' billati hi ahsan. فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةً كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. You know, and as Allah says, وَمَا يَلَقَّاهَا إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا وَمَا يَلَقَّاهَا إِلَّا ذُو حَظٍّ عَظِيمٍ. Those who are the lucky ones, they have that quality. The quality of paying kindness with badness, that is badness with kindness. If somebody treats you good, bad, show kindness to him. It's difficult, but that is the best conduct of the believer. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he should help us so that we can try to emulate the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we say it correct, may Allah accept it. When we make mistake, may Allah forgive us. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of she looked at the Quran we read and solve all our problems for us. Those who are not well, may Allah cure their diseases for them. And those who are looking for work, may Allah give them. Those who need Marriage, may Allah give them. Those who want to go Hajj, may Allah make it possible for them to go Hajj. We have a lot of people here, they haven't made Hajj. Plenty people. Even me, Safadi, I'm included. So we pray to Allah, may Allah make it possible for us to make Hajj, inshallah. Inshallah. Inshallah, we pray for us, inshallah.
Gracias.